But there are three reasons why I really wanted to introduce Curt, and it has to do with film, farming, and the future. So if you had a choice of learning about corn subsidies from, say, I don't know, an agricultural economist from anywhere university, or you could watch a film about it, and you could have some popcorn and a beer and get together with your friends and learn not only about corn subsidies, but childhood obesity and the tragedy that is the loss of rural communities and farmers, which would you go with? Because I'm going to the film. And actually, from a public health perspective, film has been very effective in changing behavior. And what I've learned in my years of doing this work is that if we're going to change the way people eat and farm, then we have to change the way they think about food. And the way we help people think about food differently is through mass media. So we have a lot to owe for King Corn. I think it is among the top three films in the last decade that has changed the way we think about food. It stands head and shoulders above with Food Inc. and Super Size Me. King Corn helped us understand the problems with corn. As Americans, we like entertaining education, and that's what film does. So, in introducing Curt, I also warned him that I would be digging up some dirt on him. Funny how that has a negative connotation, right? So I sent an email out to all of my colleagues in the Food and Society Policy Fellowship, and I said, what do you know about Curt? Don't hold back. And, like good organic soil, I only unearthed the positive. And the best comment I got was from Deb Eschmeyer, who is the co-founder of Food Corps. And what she said was, yeah, so Curt lives in New York, went to fancy urban schools. He has a degree in history from Yale. But you know, his first love was farming. As a kid, he kept a basket of John Deere tractor brochures by his bed and read them until the pages were torn. And get this, he spent the day of his senior prom plowing and took his prom photos on the tractor. A direct quote from Curt, farming is the career I always wanted to have and the one I most admire, even while I'm living in 400 square feet in Manhattan. The other point I want to make is about the future. And we know the age of farmers. We know we're facing really difficult times in agriculture. But Food Corps brings us an amazing crop of young, eager farmers. And I can't thank you enough, Curt and Deb, for bringing this enthusiasm, because if we're going to save this beautiful planet with our food system, it's going to be through young farmers. So without further ado, please help me welcome Curt Ellis.
Thank you so much. I have a little bit of a concern that Melinda found my FBI file instead of my biography for writing that. Thank you so much. I want to thank Organic Valley and the other sponsors who made it possible for me to be here and for all of us to be here today, and all of you who donate to and support Moses. This really is such an incredible gathering of people. And I also want to thank Chris and Faye for having me here and for everything they did to make sure this event went off so beautifully. I've been wanting to come to Moses for a long, long time, and this is my first chance to actually do it. And I just want you all to know that you are heroes of mine, and I'm so grateful to all of you for the work you do every day. This is really the great meeting of the minds and the great meeting of the hands doing this work. So thank you all for being here. Give yourselves a round of applause. So how many of you watched the Super Bowl a couple of weeks ago? Decent. I see. It's not a Super Bowl in the Midwest if the Packers aren't playing. I see. Fine. How many of you maybe have seen on replay or watched on some two-year-old smartphone the replay of that Chrysler commercial featuring Clint Eastwood? There's this kind of talked-about commercial from the Super Bowl from halftime in which Clint Eastwood is in the locker room. Clint Eastwood is, America's old and wise and slightly creepy grandfather. And he's there in the locker room talking about this idea that it's halftime in America. This idea that we've reached a point where we're at a break and we may be a little bit behind. You see on screen images of Detroit empty of people. You see images of people waking up, regular everyday Americans waking up, feeling burned by the American dream. And there's this sense in the ad that I think is really very honest, that what we've been doing, the strategy we've been running in this game, the play we've been running over and over again in this game, isn't working anymore. It's halftime in America. We know we need a lot right now. People are hurting right now. We need jobs. We need energy independence. We need to breathe new life into our cities and towns. We need our kids to grow up strong and smart. We need the next generation to lead. We need all those things right now. And they're possible. And Clint Eastwood thinks they're possible too. He thinks this is a moment when we're at halftime, we're going to get back out there, and we're going to win this game. The second half is about to begin. We're going to make a comeback. The world's going to hear the roar of our engines. And then, to end the ad, these sweeping shots of a factory come on the screen, and these SUVs roll off the assembly line. And you feel for a moment this like welling up of joy and pride in America and this sense of possibility and promise. And then something doesn't feel quite right. You realize that we're about to take the field again and run the same play. We're putting the same team on the field. We've got the same rules to the game, and we're about to run the same play over and over and over again for the whole second half of the game. I don't think that's how we're going to win this game. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm glad to see Detroit's factories open again. I'm glad to see those men and women back at their jobs. I'm glad to see America making something. Factories have helped make America great. But I do think that image, leaving that ad with an image of a factory, is a little disappointing. It feels a little old. It doesn't feel like a new idea. It doesn't feel like the kind of fresh energy we need coming out of the locker room for the second half. The way I see it, we've really spent the last 200 years in this country running this one play over and over and over again, running the assembly line play, running the factory play. We've gotten really good at it. We've pushed the limits of what that play can do. I don't think I need to tell this audience what the factory play has meant in food and agriculture, both good and bad. You've seen it over a lifetime. I've come to this more recently, kicking my own education about food and farming into high gear after I graduated from college and decided to move to Iowa with my best friend to play farmer for a year. It didn't take long for us to notice that this kind of factory model was being played out in the way we eat. And that made sense to me. I had grown up the youngest of six kids in Oregon. My siblings had this old vinyl record from Steve Martin back when he did stand-up comedy in the 70s. And there was a bit he did where he said, you know, I think maybe everything at McDonald's is actually made of the same stuff. Like, if you go into the back room of a McDonald's, you'd see this conveyor belt going by with these different molds going by, and it'd be like, hamburger, French fries, paper box. And what I didn't realize is that that's actually true. It actually is just this vat of this stuff. And the stuff, of course, is corn. The stuff that fries the fries, that fattens the burger, that sweetens the soda, the stuff that's the wax on the paper bag you take it all home in, originates on a corn farm. The other thing I didn't know, though, when I got to Iowa, was the extent to which this beautiful place, this perfect acre of corn that Ian and I grew, surrounded by a sea of 90 million green and gold acres just like it, was something of an assembly line too. But the reality is that as America has gotten better and better at running this one play, as we've pushed the limits of what this assembly line model can do. As we've forgotten that there are other plays we might be able to run, behind every factory, we've built another factory.
January soybeans at 545, down 1 3/4, and May soybeans at 548, down 1 1/4 cents.
Three fungicides and an insecticide. What do corn growers really want? More corn. Way, way more corn.
Go where no one's gone before, more corn.
That's more like it. Comprised of 4 separate...
Curt Ellis.
Hey, Ian Cheney.
Hi, Ian. Al Marth.
How you doing?
Good. How are you guys doing?
Good.
What can I help you with today?
Fertilizer.
Fertilizer, okay. What kind of ground are you guys working on? Is it a sandier type soil?
We haven't done any analysis of it. It's a basic brown.
Okay. Essentially, the crop needs nutrients to in order to produce the maximum yield, and you want to have the biggest potential out there to get the biggest yield you can. Past couple years, we've had probably 200 bushel corn around here, and we like that a lot. So, there you go.
Thanks. You look like a farmer now.
Stand right in this area, you'll probably get a good smell of the ammonia.
Oh yeah, I get it.
Any advice for driving with this thing?
Yeah, don't hit anything. That's a bad thing.
Okay, we know that there's 43,560 square feet in an acre. And we're going to try to mark out 1 acre for corn.
Do I push this forward?
Yeah, push it forward.
Terrified. All right, we're up. Are you kidding?
Well, you want to go another round?
Yeah, but slower maybe.
No, we gotta go this speed.
Here's the brake. Oh, where's the brake?
Ow!
Alright, I'm very bad at driving a tractor right now.
Well, let's go.
All right.
Thanks largely to our 150-pound injection of anhydrous ammonia, we could grow 4 times as much corn as our great-grandparents could have gotten from the same piece of land.
You gotta follow this little line.
Stop!
On almost every farm, there was a tank of ammonia fertilizer. And it seemed to be working. Elevators were full in almost every town we saw. In fact, they were a lot more than full.
All that abundance, of course, has come at a cost. And you know that better than I do. If you live in this part of the country, you see that cost every day. Our love affair with assembly line agriculture has pushed people out of the way. With bigger tractors and bigger fields, we've needed fewer farmers and fewer farm families. It's an old story, but like a Dickens serial novel, a new chapter keeps coming out every year. I read the latest installment last weekend about a company in Iowa that's field testing what they call drone farming. Totally GPS-guided, farmerless tractors that can run the fields day and night with no need for people at all. We've pushed the limits of what this kind of assembly line model for agriculture can mean. We've freed a bunch of people up who didn't want to be farmers anymore. We've increased the productivity of our farms. But somewhere along the way, we let it go too far. We let the assembly line in agriculture become a disassembly line for rural America. during the year we lived in Iowa, growing corn in the town of Green, the high school consolidated with the next town over because there weren't enough students to fill the desks. This is a town that in its heyday had 3 car dealerships, it had an opera house, it had 2 grocery stores, it had passenger rail service all the way to Chicago. Now it just has the 1 grocery with a produce counter short enough that even in the middle of the most beautiful topsoil in the country, you're basically living in a food desert. The only place those rail lines go now is out to the big feedlots out west and the corn syrup wet mills in Cedar Rapids. You can trace this chain of factories all the way back from the fast joint where Steve Martin sees the goo going into the molds to the corn syrup plant where the rail lines go to our cornfield itself and its ammonia fertilizer. But if you look hard enough, you even see another factory behind that.
To compensate for the erosion of the soil's natural fertility, corn farmers now rely on phosphate fertilizer from mines across the southeast and anhydrous ammonia, some of which comes from factories in Iowa.
From this control room, we're controlling the process of making around 1,100 tons a day of anhydrous ammonia. It all starts right here.
This is the kitchen.
This is the kitchen, that's right.
This is a 0.5 liter of anhydrous ammonia. If this were in a regular room without the hoods, we would have to evacuate the building. It would be that strong. No, I'm serious. It would be.
This is exactly what you put on your crop on your acre of corn.
When we grew our corn, we had injected our acre with 130 pounds of fertilizer, giving us the promise of a huge yield by giving our corn easy access to nitrogen.
We have 3 primary raw materials for the production of ammonia. Air from the air we're breathing, atmospheric air, which contains around 79% nitrogen, and that's where the nitrogen source comes from. Steam, and then natural gas, which is methane or CH4. About 80% of the cost of producing ammonia is in the cost of natural gas.
To produce enough fertilizer for our 1 acre field, the furnaces at Terra Industries burned 2,000 cubic feet of natural gas. Anhydrous ammonia can be an expensive ingredient in Iowa's abundant harvest.
That last fact never ceases to humble me. Just to fertilize our 1 acre of corn, an area, to keep the metaphor going, a little bit smaller than a football field, took 2,000 cubic feet of natural gas just for one application, one time of anhydrous ammonia. We know how little fossil fuel is left for us to tap into. We're already hydrofracking. We're already drilling down into the shale gas to get at the hard-to-get stuff. We're already seeing people who live above those wells turn on their kitchen taps and flammable water is coming out because of the contamination from those wells. We're pushing the limits of what this factory model can do. And there's no doubt it's a powerful model. It has real costs, and it has real benefits, too. It's the kind of high-risk, high-reward play that you run just a few times in a game, at the right moments. Then you get the benefits. You get incredible abundance. But if you run it over and over and over, if you run it like it's the only play you know how to run, you get something that starts to cross the line and become a little bit more absurd. You get the kind of thing we got from our acre of corn. You get 10,000 pounds of fast food. You get the feed for 4,000 confinement-raised corn-fed hamburgers. You get the sweetener for 57,000 cans of soda from 1 acre of corn. An incredible quantity of food that we know is incredibly bad for us. Childhood obesity rates have tripled in the last 30 years. 1 in 3 kids growing up today is expected to get type 2 diabetes. The majority of us in this room can expect to have a shorter life expectancy than our parents. We've taken that assembly line model to extremes, and it's not working for us anymore. The food doesn't taste right. The farms don't smell right. The kids aren't growing up right. Just running the same play over again isn't going to help us. I think we need a new strategy for the second half when it comes to food and agriculture in America. I think the first play we should run, the first new model we should try, is the schoolyard. It's probably not the elementary school you grew up going to. I know it's not the elementary school I grew up going to, but I think it's a school we could create together. And it's the kind of school that is already starting to spring up around this country. It's a school where food matters. It's a school where food is treated as something fundamental, as something essential to our survival, to our health, to our prosperity, to our wealth as a nation. Because it is. Food is fundamental. Back before there was such a thing as the assembly line, people needed food. Our ancestors had to get out of the cave and hunt and gather and bring back the very highest quality food they could for their kids to survive. Once we figured out agriculture, we had to save seed and steward the soil for our tribe to grow. We inherited that DNA. We're hardwired to believe that food is fundamental, that food is the most important thing we've got, that we've got to get food right. We better not cheapen it. The model of taking the assembly line to extremes is a model we've been running for a long time, 200 years. But the food is fundamental model is the one we ran for the 200,000 years before that. And I think we can bring it back in a way that isn't going back in time, but is going forward. Sitting with us in this room are members of the pioneering class of Food Corps, an organization that a year ago I helped launch with Deb Eschmeyer, who's a farmer from Ohio who's here with us, with Cecily Upton. All right. A group of us came together to start this organization that you can think of as a Teach for America for healthy school food, a Peace Corps for healthy school food right here at home. What we do is find the most talented emerging leaders in the fields of food and agriculture around the country. With the help of some pretty heroic nonprofit organizations in the places where we work, extension offices, universities, nonprofit organizations, we link these young leaders up with schools. Schools that have the potential to be transformed into this model for the way we approach food and farming for the future. The schoolyard is an important place to be doing this work. The schoolyard's the front lines in America's obesity epidemic. 32 million kids eat school food 5 days a week. In the kind of low-income communities Food Corps serves, this is the majority of the calories most of these kids get is in school, through school breakfast, school lunch, and after-school snack. What we feed these kids in school, what we teach them about food, the kind of food culture we give them, the kind of understanding we give them about farmers, affects how they learn, how they feel, how they grow up, how long they're going to live. The things kids grow up eating in school are the same things they're going to feed their own families someday. So if all we serve in a school cafeteria are the things I remember from my school lunch, the chicken patties and the French fries, then fast food is all we're ever going to see on America's dinner tables. Food Corps is small. There are 50 people in this first class. So we send our service members to the places we think they're needed most, the places they can make the biggest difference. We send them to Iowa, where children growing up surrounded by the nation's richest topsoil too often don't have easy enough access to fruits and vegetables in school. We send them to Mississippi and Arkansas and all across the South, where social and racial determinants of health have led 20% of children already into obesity. We send them to the Southwest, where Native communities have some of the highest rates of type 2 diabetes in the country. Take the Tohono O'odham Nation in Arizona, a place where 30 years ago type 2 diabetes was completely unknown. Today it's being diagnosed in children there as young as 6, and 60% of the adult population is expected to have the disease. Food Corps has 50 leaders in our first class. They're spread across 10 states now, doing a year of full-time national service around healthy food and agriculture. Many of our Corps members work in the community they grew up in or a community they went to school in. Many more bring experiences from their own lives, growing up on food stamps or overcoming obesity as a kid, that give them credibility with the people they serve. This is Stephanie Conant, sitting over here. Steph's grandfather was a farmer and a soil science professor at University of Wisconsin. Steph went to Luther College in Iowa and now is serving there in Decorah. She speaks the language of the Corn Belt. We're glad to have her here this morning. Once our service members are placed into a community where they can put down roots, they work with farmers and teachers and chefs and business leaders to help kids build an enduring relationship to healthy food. They use a simple recipe to make that happen, one with just 3 ingredients. The first is knowledge. Kids need to know what healthy food is. They need to know where it comes from. They need to care where it comes from. A typical elementary age kid watches 3.5 hours of TV a day, and they get 3.5 hours of nutrition education in school in a year. Food Corps service members work closely with teachers in the classroom to help kids learn about real food and help them learn to love it. With us today is Mauricio Rosas Alvarez. Mauricio grew up in Mexico and Los Angeles, and he earned dual degrees in culinary arts and nutrition at Johnson & Wales University. He's now serving in Des Moines. I got to hear Mauricio on a radio interview from Iowa recently when he said, "It feels good to work with the next generation. You get to pass on knowledge that's going to outlive you. You take the greatest out of you and you put it into the next generation." What Mauricio is working to pass on is his knowledge of what good food is all about. In one day of his service with the National Center for Appropriate Technology and Des Moines Public Schools, our partners in the area, Mauricio did a classroom lesson that featured 4 different varieties of apples, all grown 12 miles from the school. Everyone rub your bellies and say, fiber, when you see an apple. Let's try that. Fiber. Mauricio did that trick. Kids loved it. And they loved Mauricio, and they loved the apples. They particularly loved the greening apples, the heirloom variety Mauricio had brought in. Now when Mauricio walks the halls in the Des Moines Public Schools, kids run up to him and say, fiber. Mauricio saw the principal in the hall recently, too. And I think he was hoping for the but he didn't get that. Instead, the principal said, "Mauricio, the kids keep coming up to me and saying, how are we going to get these apples into our school meals?" Mauricio has a big idea of what's possible when it comes to food and nutrition education. Getting our kids to be eager consumers of locally grown apples is just one piece of that. I remember reading Mauricio's application to Food Corps, in which he said, "We build our community, our values, and our morals at the table. Food represents our joy, our medications, our companion, and our lessons." And he's right. Hats off to you, Mauricio. The second part of growing up with a strong relationship to good food is engagement. Kids need to be able to get their hands in the dirt, to be able to smell the leaves of a tomato plant. And to make that tactile connection, our service members plant school gardens, some of them a full acre in size with greenhouses and chickens. They use them as gateways for getting kids connected to the land, connected to Whole Foods, willing to try new things, a kind of gateway drug for good. Gardens also give gateways for parents and teachers and community members to get involved in the life of food in a school, to get involved in food again, period. They give the larger community a chance to come together and work side by side to grow something good. This is Daniel Schultz, who's also here with us today. He's a Wisconsin native, grew up east of here in Jackson, and went to college at UW. Dan knows what it's like to get his hands in the dirt. He spent a summer interning on a farm, and he started the campus garden at the University of Wisconsin, Green Bay. He probably doesn't want me to tell you he also started Sustainability is Sexy Month in college. Daniel's now serving alongside Mauricio in Des Moines, where they run after-school gardening and cooking programs that get kids to grow and chop and taste good food themselves. School gardens like Daniel's creating are magical to kids. They tap into that thing deep within us that says, food is important. They tap into that piece of our DNA that makes us all want to be farmers. We had one service member write in recently, Sarah from Wilmington, North Carolina, to say she'd started a student gardening club. And at their second meeting, a little boy came up to her and said, oh, I just couldn't sleep last night. It was like Christmas. Then we heard from another service member, Jess, who's serving in Oregon, who decided to have a garden naming contest among the students she works with. One of the students, Edouard, told her he wanted to name it the Golden Garden. Jess said, that's nice, Edouard, I like it. Why do you want to name it the Golden Garden? Because when I close my eyes and I think of the garden, everything turns to gold. Hats off to you, Daniel, for bringing the magic of school gardens to Des Moines, and boots on. The last element of the school food environment that we believe all children should have is access, a chance for kids to eat the food they've now studied and grown every single day. Farm-to-school connections get healthy food from local producers into school cafeterias. They empower lunch ladies and lunch gentlemen to not just be working on a kind of assembly line for school meals, but helps them become chefs and teachers. It turns school cafeterias into places where healthy food, local food, is celebrated and served. And quite often, you get to meet the farmer who grew it. This access piece is admittedly the hardest. You can't change the way school food is sourced on a dime. You can't buy a whole lot of high-quality food for a dollar a kid. This work is going to be slow. But if we can do it, not just Food Corps, but all the people who are working on this farm-to-cafeteria project around the country, it'll change the lives of 32 million kids. And it'll change the lives of the farmers who supply that $10 billion annual market of school food. With us today and working on that project at the grassroots, or at least at the tubers, is Leah Chapman. Leah also serves in Northeast Iowa with the Food and Fitness Initiative, and a whole team of AmeriCorps service members there, Melanie and Elizabeth and Sonia, who are all here. Leah grew up in Nebraska and Florida and spent plenty of her childhood wandering around her grandparents' apple orchard. She cares deeply about farm workers and farmers and all people who produce our food. So wherever she's gone in her life, she's worked hard to get them a good market and fair pay. In college at the University of Florida, Leah worked closely with a team of farmers to start a campus CSA and coordinated its pilot year. She helped convince Aramark to shift sourcing on 30% of dining hall food to come from local farms. She worked with Harvest of Hope doing farm worker assistance. She got invited to the Clinton Global Initiative because of her leadership in fair trade coffee. Now Leah's brought her skills to Iowa and Northeast Iowa's public schools. If you read her blog, you'll see the impact she's having on behalf of local farmers. Next week, she says in one post, North Fayette schools will be receiving 13 bushels of apples and 45 pounds of local carrots to feature in the school's breakfasts and lunches. These farm-to-school relationships, even when they start small, are where the pieces begin to come together. Kids learn about those heirloom greening apples in their classroom. At recess, they're running to their school garden, checking for weeds and yelling, fiber. And when they go inside for lunch, those same apples from a farmer 12 miles away are what's on their tray. At every step along this localized supply chain, those apples and carrots are supporting good jobs and rewarding work for local people. The engines of school cafeterias are hard at work supporting local farms. Hungry kids are getting to grow up eating real food. And well-nourished, they're learning better in classes and are able to pay better attention. And at every step along the way, every stop along the farm-to-school chain, neighbors have an opportunity to meet each other and shake hands and help kids and connect to the land, connect to farmers, and support each other economically while they do it. Hats off to you, Leah, for helping get local food into Northeast Iowa schools, and shades on. The 50 women and men who are in Food Corps' first class are just a tiny, tiny sampling of the emerging leaders who are clamoring to get into the food systems field right now. Many of them are in this room. 1,229 people sought us out for these 50 spots and said, I want to be a farmer. I want to become a chef. I want to set food policy someday. And I want to start by spending a year of service giving good food to kids. The career goals these people have, and their career goals all 1,229 of those applicants have, the career goals the young farmers in this room have, are at least as important as the work that's going on right now in schools. Secretary Vilsack says we need 100,000 new farmers, and there's going to be land for them to farm. 1 in 3 acres of Iowa land right now is owned by someone in their 70s. It's going to change ownership within a decade. Who's going to farm that land and how? If leaders like this can take the passion they come in with and mix it with experience and skills learned in a year of service in Food Corps, a year of apprenticeship on a farm, then apply it to a lifetime of work in food and farming and health, either in a career as a farmer or in a career in a field that recognizes that farming matters. That won't just change school food. That's going to change all food. We're learning everything we can from the pioneers who have paved the way for sustainable food and agriculture in this country. Our service members are too. Every one of them has a mentor, a leader further along in the fields of food and farming and public health, who's handing on their knowledge, helping this young person pursue the career of their dreams. Melinda, who introduced me, is one of them. And many of those mentors are farmers, because many of our service members want to be farmers. We asked them who they wanted for a mentor, and I pulled up Corbin's note. One of our service members wrote and said, it would be truly great to get closer to figuring out how to make my dream of becoming a successful farmer a reality. Whether it's an urban or rural farmer, a young one or an old one, a farmer with 2 acres or 200, I don't really care. I just want to be mentored by a well-respected, successful farmer. You all are the heroes to these leaders. When I think about where these guys are headed, when I think about the career trajectories ahead for Food Corps service members and for young farmers of all stripes, I can't help but think about Wendell Berry, who was an inspiration to me in the way he talked about there being three kinds of solutions in the world. There are solutions that deepen the problem they were supposed to fix. That's the idea of global warming is happening, so I better get a bigger air conditioner. There's a second kind of solution which kind of moves the problem around. That's the idea of corn-based ethanol, maybe, which ignores the fact that 2,000 cubic feet of natural gas had to be burned to fertilize that field of fuel. And then there are solutions that are actual solutions, solutions that solve for pattern, as Wendell Berry says, that instead of causing more problems or pushing the problem around, that actually cause more solutions as they roll out. This feels like one of those things that can cause more solutions. If the factory model is full of hidden costs in food and agriculture, the food is fundamental model is full of hidden benefits. Kids get a cycle of mutual reinforcement. They get the knowledge of what healthy food is. They get hands-on engagement with how it grows and what it tastes like. They get reliable access to it every day in what they eat. And then, like Barry says, there are other solutions embedded in there too. Solutions for our service members who get launched into lifelong careers as farmers and teachers and public health leaders and policymakers. Solutions for local economies, where farmers get to grow the very highest quality food and sell it to schools that need it and kids who are hungry. And solutions for the communities we work in, where volunteer networks come together to sustain and expand something as simple as a school garden, and then realize they could turn their energy to other areas of social and environmental justice and make a difference. That's my hope. Because we need jobs. We need energy independence. We need to breathe new life into our cities and towns. We need our kids to grow up strong and smart. We need the next generation to lead. And I think we need the factory too. But as a play we run sometimes, at a play we run when the benefits clearly outweigh the costs, not as the only play we think to try. I guess what I like about this schoolyard model is it's a little messy. It's not meant to be some perfect machine. It's meant to be a place where we keep learning, where we recognize that this game isn't going to be won if we just roar our engines and pretend we have all the answers. It's a game that's going to be won because we keep asking questions. I think with that attitude, and if we put our faith in the men and women around this country who are raising their hands to do this work, saying, I want to serve in Food Corps, I want to be a farmer, if we put those players on the field and we run this play, I think we could change the way this whole game is played going forward. Thanks. Thank you. Thank you. I so appreciate it. I wonder if our Iowa service members would be willing to come up and take a few questions with me. All right. So there is a microphone right down front here. If any of you have questions for me or for any of our great service members from Iowa, please put your hand up and the mic will come your way. There's one in the back there. Oh, Faye has one too.
I want to know if you guys could tell us what happened that turned you to realize this was what you wanted to do with your life. So just a way to describe the experience.
Awesome. I'm going to introduce these guys, Steph Conan, Dan Schultz, Leah Chapman, and Mauricio Rosas Alvarez.
Thank you, Curt, for the wonderful introduction. Like he said, my grandfather was a farmer, and I have this beautiful memory of him planting a pear tree for me in his garden when he didn't inherit the farm, but he had this huge garden in his backyard. And food, because of that, has always been very important to me. And growing up, in order to be the best person, you know, you can be, I think it's really important to be fueled by that food and how we use our environment. So when I saw the Food Corps application, with my interest in health and the environment and food, it was like a dream come true, the best thing ever. And I guess it's been a great gift, and I'm looking forward to the future and what that brings. I hope that answers the question.
So for me, I was the product of this bad food environment. I had cheese breadsticks for lunch. I went home to pizza. I had macaroni and cheese for dinner. And that's not real food to me. So that had a negative effect on my health. And as a teenager, I actually became obese. I was 250 pounds. I wasn't happy with my life, with the not the sense that I was depressed, but I mean, being in high school, being overweight, it's rough. So I decided to make a change, and I adapted a whole foods diet, started running, doing my own exercise program, and through that, I've been able to lose 65 pounds. And I realized through that process, not only is the food good for you, but the food, the people who are producing it, and the environment it is in, it should be beneficial, and it should be a full circle approach, and it should benefit everyone involved with that. So that was my background.
Hi, everyone. I guess my food revolution, per se, happened inside a University of Florida classroom. I took a class on, it was called Religion and Environmental Movements in the Global South, and it explored the connections between agriculture and food and food ethics and farm worker rights, and it kind of just clicked for me, and I became super passionate about sustainability and agriculture, and then I saw the food core application, and I thought it would be a perfect fit for me, so.
I went to culinary school, so I have no agricultural background whatsoever. But I was studying both nutrition and culinary arts and figured that the job of a dietitian or of a chef is extremely hard when you're not using real food because you're just compensating with all these added things. And so I kind of used Food Corps as a way for me to get back and learn where food comes from. And it's very shocking that in culinary school in America, we're not teaching people where their food comes from. So every day I have like major realizations that I didn't know food came from this plant, or that there's a lot of, like, time has like three different types of time. I didn't know that existed. But I feel that we also don't prioritize food in America. And so I felt that by spreading the word out to prioritize food, not only build community, but build a sustainable one.
Thanks.
Hi, my name is Marianne, and I'm a parent volunteer on the health and wellness committee at my school. And I need some suggestions on how to get the local producers to come and give to either donate and or purchase their organic and sustainable products to our school, because we're a private school in Cross Plains, Wisconsin.
Great, and hopefully purchase. We really, you know, one thing we recognize is that you can't ask everything for free from farmers who are working so hard to try to find a market in the first place. So we believe very strongly that these schools should open up the pocketbooks, not just the classrooms, to farmers.
I would say invite the farmer to your wellness team meetings and try to involve them with the school community as much as possible. We did a producer visit at one of my schools where he took some local winter squash and took it around the cafeteria, and he donated some squash to make spiced squash cookies. They were like a healthy cookie for the kids for dessert. And kind of just made the connections between, like, this is the squash that I grew from my farm and you're eating it, and this is kind of how my farm works. And so just trying to involve them as a part of school culture, I would say, and they might be more willing to work with you as a wellness team and with your food service director. Does that kind of answer the question?
Hi.
Hi.
I've never heard of Food Corps before, so I'm really excited to hear about this and learn a lot more.
Awesome. We have a bunch of postcards here. We'll maybe Deb can help with some postcards and distributing those up and down the aisles. If you want one, raise your hands. Deb, they're right over here in my bag, and we can make it happen.
I want one. Anyway, I'm a student at Purdue University in Indiana, and I have plans to do research with educating children about eating better and understanding all of that. So I was wondering if you had a certain activity or lesson where you noticed the children's attitudes and behaviors start to change and spark their excitement for fresh food.
So in Des Moines, Iowa, we've taken advantage of these costumes we have. We have an apple costume and a carrot costume. So we only dress up if it's a local produced good to really like make it like kind of just plant in their mind. So we always highlight that and say, not other apples aren't that bad if they're coming from Washington, but since they're grown in Iowa, they're a little bit more cooler, kind of like you guys. So kind of just having fun, interactive. We do life cycles of the plants. So we'll go down on the ground and be like, well, now we're harvesting carrots, then we'll stand up nice and tall like corn, then we'll start growing and reach over like a sunflower, and then we'll jump up in the trees to get the apple. So, and always bring props in. We had an activity where we had carrots, and then we showed them purple carrots, and their minds were blown. So just really fun activities like that.
And to add, I think the food also speaks for itself. I know when I've done K through 12 education, you'll be surprised at what the kids will like. I'll come in with a big bag of fresh kale chips that I've made, and the teachers will be like, oh, well, I don't know, they've never tried it. What do you think? And I think it's going to speak for itself. And Leah had a case where the kids were not just eating the kale chips, but the raw kale. And they came up to her and said, oh, this is so good, you know. They're just stuffing it. I think their bodies register, too, that it's good. On a university level, I know at Luther College, producer visits were huge. And getting to interact with the farmer really revolutionized how I thought about the local food movement. I was originally from Fairfax Station, Virginia, and getting to meet the farmers in Iowa and hear more about their work really made me want to try their food. And then when I realized how good it was, I was like, how can I get in this movement? So producer visits, I think actions, like Dan was talking about, what the food does for your body. Not only does it taste good, but it's going to help you grow, helps too.
Fiber. All right. Yes.
I have several comments, and you may want to turn me off at some point, okay? I really applaud,
I'll get the remote.
I really applaud you for what you're doing, and I hope we can see this, though, as an intergenerational movement,
yes,
rather than just
yes,
strictly children, because children go home. And if they're seeing these bad food habits at home, it's a disconnect. At this phase of my life, I'm substitute teaching, I'm sorry to say, rather than being a contracted teacher, though I have been one. And I've had the opportunity to see various food programs in the schools. And I've followed the news in terms of Michelle Obama's initiatives. I can say that in this area that I substitute teach in the various schools, how it's implemented is widely different. You know, there's supposed to be, as I understand it, an unlimited amount of fruit and vegetables, and the children can get as many as they want. Sometimes. Not often. If you go to Minnesota, they have had it for a couple years, at least in some of the districts that I was in. So there's a wide disparity there. I also would hope that the focus can be on, while the focus is on nutrition, and I too fell into the trap that I was eating for calories and not for food value. And here it took me until about 5 years ago when I heard Dr. Green and some other experiences to realize it's not calories, it's our life. It's what makes us healthy or not. And so I would hope that in terms of the foods that you're going to be emphasizing, that we all emphasize as we've turned to organic or transitioning to organic, that we're gonna look at those dirty dozen, and if you're not familiar with those, that you do a Google search. And apples are the number one dirtiest fruit generally. And so that we are minimizing the herbicides and pesticides on the most vulnerable of our food chain, because there are some that are not as vulnerable as that. Next is, I'm a farmer's daughter. My parents died in 08. I am transitioning the farm to organic. After I saw the farm being rented, and I didn't have any impact on that. My brother wouldn't allow me to. Being rented to traditional farmers who are now ticked that they can't plant their corn. And I have planted 60 acres, a portion of the tillable acreage, in winter wheat, and will be organic in June or July. But I also think it's been a journey for me, because while my father was a very good agriculturist, I think, and a sensitive steward of the land, many farmers, regardless of their age, are not. And they think that their way is the only way. I also think, though, that when my parents went to assisted living or a nursing home, they were clueless. The facilities were clueless about what kind of nutrition elderly people should have. And my parents were very aware of they grew food like we're supposed to grow food. And they canned and did all those other things. And I think that by having industrialized food and nursing home facilities and assisted living facilities, we are shortchanging the people that are very aware of how we're supposed to eat. And my mother, every time I went to visit her, I was shocked at how much weight she'd gained. But I also saw the food that she was provided, and it irritated me.
Thanks. I think the comment you made about it being a long journey for all of us is exactly right. And that's why if we start the conversation with kids in school, and if we keep it going all the way through our lives, then there's actually a chance of making a difference at all of these stops along the way. I don't have any misconception that improving school food in the modest ways you can do it, you know, with a year of national service, is going to transform the entire food system. But I think if we raise a generation of kids who believe that food is important, who believe that food is fundamental, I think then we will transform the nation's food system.
I have a question for you, how we can sustain the 1 year that each of these students started. I was in the AmeriCorps program with the Farm to School program for years, you know, got food into the schools, did a lot what you've done, and then it kind of faded, you know, with a few things added on. But, you know, do you have some insight, Curt, as well, you know, how can you support people like this and the schools that are willing to start these projects? They come and they go in a year. What can our communities do? What can you do? What can you do? so that it continues and we keep getting the healthier foods and more fruits and vegetables and the local and all that.
Great. Really important question. And some of these folks are interested in serving a second year in Food Corps. Is that right? Yeah. So we, first of all, some of these particular folks will be there for more than 1 year, which is a great way to build continuity. Second, we're adding another layer onto our programming this year, which is a statewide team leader role, so that there's someone there to kind of carry the web of relationships and connections forward from one class's progress to the next class's progress. And the third piece is that we imagine we'll be working in a particular school for something like 5 years. We know it takes a long time for these things to begin to get institutionalized, for food service directors to build local supply chains and begin making long-term contracts with local suppliers. It takes a long time for teachers to get used to having a school garden and for parents to step up and build a garden club around it where they really come together to sustain that garden over the long term. So we are looking for long-term sustainability of these projects. We're looking for long-term institutionalization of procurement practices and of the values of food being important in school. But we think it's going to take a little while before we actually get there.
Hello. I was actually just wondering more about the kind of programs you have in more urban places. For instance, Detroit, like you started speaking about, that's where my family is from. And they live in a city without a grocery store. And so I just wonder like what kind of programs you have like out there and what you're doing out there. Because when last I was there, I noticed a lot of urban gardening going on, and which I thought was really great. There still seems to be this disconnect from people from that city because they have, they don't have that natural connection with farmland. They aren't coming from Iowa or Wisconsin. And so I was just kind of wondering what the work was out, you know.
Great. So we work in a number of urban places. We work in Flint, Michigan. We work in Boston, Massachusetts. We work in Jackson, Mississippi. Mostly these are smaller cities or mid-sized cities. And that's just in large part been because it's easier to break in those places. And those are places where there's, in many cases, not very much work going on related to school garden and farm to school and ag in the classroom and stuff like that when we enter in those places. And there are other cities like, you know, New York, where our national office is and where I live. There's a dozens of different programs that are kind of working on the same project in one way or another. And we have chosen to not work in those big markets yet. We want to, but we want to do it when we're able to do that at scale. I think what's really interesting about working in the very urban places is that there is so much momentum and interest around reconnecting to food and agriculture in America's cities right now. So much momentum and interest around growing a just even the tiniest school garden, or planting a gymnasium rooftop as a garden, or beginning to do just the beginnings of farm field trips. And to see that nut beginning to get cracked is very powerful, because suddenly those are families showing up at farmers markets for the weekend. Okay, we're going to do one more question. And first, I'm going to tell you, there's lots of more information about Food Corps. There's videos of these handsome people. There's more information about what everybody's up to. There's an application if you want to join to serve in Food Corps' next class at our website, foodcorps.org. Yes, our last and best question.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, you sound great.
Okay, cool. I go to school at Earlham College in Richmond, Indiana, and I help run an after-school program for kids at the Boys and Girls Club about local foods and healthy eating, and we bring them to our college farm and like help them learn how to grow their own vegetables and everything. And one thing that the people I work with on this program, one struggle we find is that there's this idea and sometimes reality of organic food being more expensive. And I guess I'm just wondering if you, I'd like to hear your experiences in trying to change that idea.
Totally great question. Any of you have thoughts on organic?
I think organic food is more expensive, and it should be more expensive because it's real food. And the fact that a lot of people are just pushing for the value per dollar reflects their true values. And so we're not going to be pushing policy while on Food Corps, but just getting their minds open and to, you know, understanding that, you know, freshness does matter and the flavor does matter and the environment matters, and just build that community and reflect on what real food was and why are we not having real food anymore.
Fantastic. We'll end with that. These folks are around if you'd like to visit. Big round of applause for Mauricio, Leah, and Dan, and Steph. Thank you all so much.